Thanks for joining us. I'm in conversation with the Governor of the Reserve Bank of India, Dr. Raghuram Rajan. Dr. Rajan, many thanks for joining us on Bloomberg. My first question to you, you've said that there are significant upside risks as far as your target of 6% is concerned for 2016. At the same time, you also say that you're likely to see it at 7%, while the goal remains at 6%. Could you explain this divergence to us?
Right. We have a monetary policy report which we started this time, which describes the various sort of forecasts using the models that we use. And when we're forecasting into the medium term, our models suggest that inflation in January 2016 will be closer to 7%. Now, models are based on a certain set of data, a certain sort of understanding, as well as past parameter estimates. Once they give us an output, we then sort of filter them through our understanding of the economy, our understanding of forces, and so on.
Sure.
But we also are governed to some extent by what the model tells us. So the understanding of my team is that as of now, given what we have set interest rates at, we are still on course to reach the 6% by 2016,
sure,
no matter what the model says.
Sure.
But the model is telling us that, you know, at least from past experience, there's a higher chance we will miss. So that's why when we say, when we talk about risks, we are saying our central forecast based on model plus subjective judgment is about 6% around 2016 Jan, but there are risks to the upside.
Sure.
There were risks in August also when we first started talking about 2016. We say they've come down a little bit,
sure,
but they still exist.
Let me talk about rates then. Now, is in the interim period, would it be right to infer that the chances of a rate cut are far lower than a rate hike?
No, I don't think it's fair to make a judgment in either direction,
sure,
that one side is more pronounced than the other. When we say we're happy right now, almost are saying that it could go either way depending on the development on data that comes in.
Sure.
What we will do is see how the data come in, feed them into our forecasts, feed them into our subjective judgment, and see whether we still feel confident that we can hit the 6% by 2016. If we feel that we're confident we can hit it by before, we have room to cut rates. If we feel that we will not be able to hit it by then, we will have the need to increase rates. So we're equally poised.
Governor, I want to talk about global monetary policy, global central banks and what they're doing. We are seeing the ECB turn the liquidity tap on at a time when the Federal Reserve is shutting it down. Bank of Japan continues to print money. We've seen China infuse liquidity. What's going on? There's so much, seems to be a divergent view of what's going on in the world. How do you see it in your own decision making?
Well, it affects us, of course, through the through global capital flows, both inward when the money is easy and outward when there is a sense that rates will increase elsewhere. My broader sense is central bankers are being asked to do too much to revive growth, bring down unemployment, and all this while keeping inflation under check and, importantly, financial stability also under control.
Sure.
They have one tool, interest rates. And my worry is that we may be in danger as a tribe of overcompensating for the deficiencies in other parts of the system. And
i.e. fiscal?
Could be fiscal, could be structural, could be reforms of various kinds, that many of them require political consensus, which may be missing. So since the central banker is a technocrat and not as subject to political influence, the feeling is the central banker has more room to maneuver, even while the rest of the system may be paralyzed because of the lack of political consensus.
Have central banks let easy policies for too long and too easy, and how can emerging markets respond to that?
My subjective judgment is yes, we have had you know, ultra low interest rates for close to now 6 years. And at some point, you have dug a hole so deep in terms of asset prices that any attempt to get out of this has immediate effect on asset prices. Now, that's a price you may be willing to pay for the attempt to get real activity going.
Sure.
But if real activity is also not responding as easily to monetary stimulus because of other impediments or the need for structural change, then you may have incurred the cost of distorted asset prices without the gain in terms of real activity. Now, there's a debate that one can have. I don't think anybody really knows what the true benefit to real activity is, or
sure,
the true cost in terms of distorted asset prices. It would be hard for one to say there's no benefit in real activity, but it would be equally hard to say there's no distortion in asset prices.
One particular point about capital flows that you mentioned, and I'm going to quote what you said in the statement today, that sudden correction in financial markets have investors misread the timing of a reversal of U.S. monetary policy. You know, while you're saying that we are in a stronger position today than we were last year, how concerned are you about the possibility of, surge of outflows or a possible crash?
I'm not overly concerned, because over this time, we have taken steps to increase the maturity of our debt inflows.
Sure.
I don't think it's so much a question of just because they have three-year debt, they won't sell and walk away. But people who are buying into three-year plus bonds and not into the very short term are reflecting more on the possibilities, the macro possibilities in the economy, etc., and are hopefully taking a longer-term view of the economy than just immediately what's going to happen to U.S. interest rates. What we saw in July, August of last year was the short-term fixed income investors sold and left. This time, hopefully, there are fewer of those waiting to sell and leave. Equity investors we've had for a long time, typically on net, they're fairly calm. Some leave, but most of them have taken a longer-term view because they're taking substantial risk and are happy to stay. So I view the concerns from the perspective of foreign flows to be more that we don't deliver on domestic policy,
right,
rather than something happens internationally. No doubt views about the Fed tightening, etc., or some other country taking action on interest rates will affect us. But I think after the initial sort of reaction, there will be ordering amongst emerging markets, in which case our domestic policies will become more important.
I'm going to push this point about capital flows just a little further and ask you a slightly rather reverse question. $17 billion on the debt side, about $14 billion in equity. We've seen this month, we've seen some outflows in the equity markets. Has there been, Governor, a situation where you've thought of what if there is much more inflows than anticipated, than expected? What if there is an avalanche of flows? What kind of problems will it have? What kind of risks that does it create?
Of course, you think about all these things. And the risk, of course, is money that doesn't stay.
Right.
So when we have a lot of money coming in that we think may be driven by potentially short-term factors,
sure,
we try and buy some protection. And the easiest way of buying protection is to build reserves when that money is coming in. But of course, reserves are not an end in themselves.
Right.
They're a buffer. And the real answer is to continuously focus on your macro environment so that your macro environment is much healthier, which means cut your fiscal deficit, improve growth, reduce inflation.
Sure.
All those good things.
You've also recently said that asset prices have risen a bit too much. My question is, how much is too much?
I hope I didn't say too much, because I don't know what too much is.
Sure.
I would say that asset prices have risen considerably.
Right.
And volatility has come down, which often is a sign that people are not, you don't have multiple opinions, people aren't overly worried.
Right.
And of course, the saying in markets is when people aren't worried is when you should get worried. And that's really the source of concern among central bankers across the world today.
Sure.
You know, maybe I worried about this a little earlier, but people are starting to worry about the extent of calmness in financial
markets.
So,
don't you run the risk of snuffing out the possibility of a boom rather than fear about a bubble?
I think you have to be careful as a central banker. You know the old William Chesney Martin story that you have to take away the punch bowl just as the party gets going. You have to be careful that you're not drinking while the party is starting up so that you're fully involved in the party and don't have the presence of mind to take away the punch bowl. That doesn't mean you take it away before the party even starts.
Sure, that's what.
You don't want to be the party pooper.
Sure.
You just want to make sure the party stays relatively sober.
So you're two drinks down, you're fine.
Well, whatever that number is, I don't know. But I think the key here is really how many indicators can you look at that give you a sense that thinking things are going to get out of kilter.
Sure.
It is always going to be subjective.
Right.
But you can't sort of dispense with that subjective judgment by saying, I can't predict asset price moves. Yes,
correct.
You can't predict exactly, and there will be a few times you're wrong, but if you're more right than wrong, because typically we've seen asset price booms accompanied by significant credit and a significant movement in a variety of things like real estate prices, exchange rates, etc., typically tend to end in tears. If we have a history of that, some leaning against the wind might be useful.
Sure.
Now, it may be that the leaning against the wind you know, is ineffective, but you should try, certainly, to see how far you can do that.
Brings me to the question on the currency. We've seen, since the last 1 year, we've seen the currency stabilize considerably, 68, 85 to where it is today. Would you think that that the currency is going to be showing far more resilience, since resilient because the overall macro factors have changed?
Now, let me emphasize one thing. When people talk about the currency, they keep talking about US dollar, Indian rupee rates. If you look over the last year, the dollar has strengthened by about 6.5% to 7%, the dollar index.
Right.
Which means against the world, the dollar has strengthened. You just look at the euro dollar, look at the Japanese dollar. So if we look at our relationship with the dollar, we get the sense that we are stable. But if we look at our relationship towards the rest of the world, you should take away the fact that we have actually appreciated quite a bit.
Sure.
Relative even to some emerging markets. That's something to keep in mind, because every time I see a headline in the paper saying rupee at its weakest for the last 7 months, I want to take the person writing that, shake them and say, do you see all the other currencies?
Sure.
And please take a view of the rupee on a broad base. Don't keep focusing on the dollar, because the dollar is moving a lot.
Sure.
Now, that said, what I want to emphasize, as we emphasize continuously, is that we are not trying to determine a level for the rupee. Any intervention that we do in exchange markets usually is bi-directional. We do it both ways. We're trying to reduce volatility, and we build reserves largely as a macroprudential tool.
To protect shocks.
To protect against shocks. We've built up reserves somewhat. Okay. But I would say today, despite our reserve buildup, the rupee has actually appreciated, even relative to the position at the beginning of the year, when you know there was a sense that we had calmed down from the the exchange rate sort of mini panic that we experienced last year.
I'm going to ask a question about the impact of this on Indian companies. I remember when the rupee was in a free fall zone, the Reserve Bank of India was at that point nudging corporations to go and hedge their forex exposures. Now it's, I mean, if I would use the word relatively stable, I find a lot of corporations not doing it. What can the RBI, first, do you see this as a risk? Secondly, what can the RBI do to tell companies to say, hey, this is important?
It is a risk. We do see data which suggests that corporations aren't hedging as much as they were last year. It's probably a natural reaction to a period of relative stability. But we would emphasize that currencies, you know, you don't want to play Russian roulette with currencies.
Right.
That it's important to hedge. no matter what your current view on the currency is. I mean, the hardest thing to predict in the world is the direction of a currency. And I think people with all sorts of models have tried and they failed. So given that, and given that volatility hasn't been excised from the market, and we're not trying to eliminate volatility. We're just saying excessive volatility, but we're also not trying to protect a level for the currency.
Sure.
So keeping that in mind, I don't think corporations should take a whole lot of comfort from the RBI always being there to rescue them. They should take appropriate measures to hedge their liabilities.
We're talking at a time, Governor, when oil prices are below 100. It's good news for all of us. The fact of the matter is, you recently actually made a call to the government saying that you might perhaps seize the moment to go ahead and cut subsidies. Is anyone listening?
I think the government has expressed its desire to move away from various forms of subsidies, including diesel. Let us see when that happens.
But you would think the time is now?
I mean, I think that when you the time when you can do it is when you don't have to move the market price at all. And in fact, you may even be able to cut. I'm not sure how long the window will be open.
Sure.
Presumably for a little while. So let us see when the government decides and, you know.
Sure. We've seen the Supreme Court of India make, you know, have a historic judgment on coal blocks. Coal blocks, I mean, the companies have been affected. There's a large bank exposure as well. Do you see a risk to the banking system? Is that a cause for concern for you?
No. So it depends a lot on what the eventual sort of assignment of costs and losses are.
Sure. We still don't know.
We still don't know. And the government has to come up with a plan in response to what the Supreme Court judgment has been. Mr. Modi, I think yesterday, spoke about using this to take a fresh look at the entire sector. I don't remember the exact words,
sure.
but that was the gist of what I got.
Sure.
And if we can use this judgment as a way of going back and taking clean decisions across the board, I think in the larger scheme of things, this may be a silver lining. Of course, the government also has the opportunity now to re-auction the blocks or to actually auction the blocks. And some flows will come in as a result. And those flows can be used to compensate the various parties who are damaged at this point for no fault of theirs. So I think we should take a view.
Sure.
There are clearly some situations where the existing promoter has to pay, some situations where, you know, the promoters and the banks will have to take losses. But in general, I think there should be a way of trying to deal with this, certainly to solve the problem of the banks.
Sure. I want to turn this conversation to the issue of corporate governance and banks, Governor. We saw the entire Syndicate Bank episode unfold before us. That raised certain serious questions about how bank chairmen are selected. What is your assessment? What do you think is the problem or issues that need to be addressed?
You know, we are certainly in conversation with the government about the process of selection of bank CMDs. But it's not just the process of selection, it's what happens after also, which is the, you know, the kind of governance that is exercised over the CMD. The government has been talking about breaking up the chairman and the managing director. So there's some oversight. The chairman is not the same as the managing director. The chairman controls the board. One could talk about reforming the composition of the board so that you have more finance-oriented people who can place some checks and balances on the MD.
Sure.
Having a longer term for the MD can be very important, giving them a horizon over which to do things. But I think also important is that pay between the differences between the public sector and the private sector cannot be so large that some modicum of not parity,
sure,
but some changes could be made there. Of course, in return for that, there should be more competition for the position of CMD. It shouldn't be a small group which gets there. I mean, all these changes can be explored.
So, but all these points that you mentioned have been addressed by the PJNI committee remote, just hasn't it? Is that...
That's where I got... That's where I'm speaking from.
No, yes. I meant implementing that in a sense would it address all of these issues, you would think?
No, I think it's work in progress, but these are some basic issues one can put in place relatively quickly. For doing more, of course, we have to see how it works out.
Sure.
I mean, from our side, we asked Dr. PJ Nayak also to look at what we are asking boards to do. We also have to look at board compensation. If you don't pay very much, who can you attract as responsible board members? All these things, I mean, sometimes we believe if we don't pay much, we will get truly motivated individuals. individuals who are motivated by public service and patriotism. That's one way of looking at it. But you can also get individuals who are motivated by entirely different and not so respectable reasons. And we have to figure out which way the evidence suggests things are going.
Sure. You also want to sort of wanted to bring about change in the internal workings of the Reserve Bank of India, the restructuring process and the idea of getting a COO. Where is that? I mean,
the restructuring,
are you altering accounting and resistance?
No. So we had a number of conversations with internal people. You see, the problem in some sense is first you have to develop the plans. That requires, we did a fair amount of consultation internally, didn't use outside consultants because we thought we could do it ourselves. Did it developed by the senior management. And then there was a period when we had to communicate internally. And I think in that period, there was a lot of apprehension about what the plans were. And so there was a little bit of noise in public. But since then, we've had a number of meetings with the staff. And I think there is a, you know, I wouldn't say there's universal agreement on every aspect of it, but there is agreement to move ahead. And that is what we're doing. We are moving ahead. Only one part of this whole process is that of bringing in a fifth DG. And that was because what our intent was is to clarify the role of executive director, which was coordinating between different departments, and a DG who would be outward looking. To do it the right way, to get the right focus on markets, right focus on banking services, the right focus on monetary policy, we needed a fifth DG. So for now, we're working with four DGs, but we will have to write to government and say, look, now we are sort of approaching you to change the RBI Act and move it from four DGs to five DGs.
Sure.
And then that conversation will go on. But much of what we had to do, we can do within what we are already permitted.
Sure.
The main thing was to get some internal buy-in. And I think this is a process by which, as we move forward, we continue to have conversations so that people understand what is going on and move forward.
So I have one final question, and this is with respect to revival. You know, we've had a new government. There's quite a bit of change in sentiment and confidence and so on. Are you seeing evidence out there of revival in the investment cycle, of corporate capex coming back? How would you read the recovery?
So, I mean, some numbers are heartening. Auto sales, for example.
Correct.
The capex numbers are very volatile as in the IIP. You know, they go up and down, but there's some sense that they're starting to pick up. But when we talk to the bankers say that it's still early days, that we haven't still seen strong, of course, credit growth has been weak, but for a variety of other reasons than just credit demand. But I would say that we're right off the starting blocks. It's a little too early to see strong evidence of the investment cycle coming into play. We've said we need to see more evidence of that to put this recovery on a firm footing. So, I mean, we're sort of hopeful. I think that Delhi is working full time. My friends in the various ministries don't get home till late at night, and they go very early in the morning. So all that activity will translate into better action on the ground. Ultimately, of course, there's this thing called animal spirits. which needs to be strongly activated. I think it was boosted by the election. Let us see how it whether it emerges into actual actions on the ground. Remember, from the time they decide to invest to the time actual investment takes place takes a little bit of time.
Sure.
So what we'll see most immediately is more completion of projects. There's some evidence of that happening, that projects are getting completed. We need to see more payments being made for projects that are completed so the system can get some liquidity. And for that, various government departments, public sector firms have to step up in that process. But as that process goes on, then the developers, the entrepreneurs will get some money in their hands, will be able to do new projects. It's a sort of virtuous cycle, early days still for it to declare that it's on.
All that, Governor Rajan. Many thanks to you for joining us.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.